Good day to all of you. I welcome you to my lecture on the fifth module, Material Science in Engineering Physics. I'm Dr. Vincent Krasta, professor from the Department of Physics, St. Joseph Engineering College. In my last classes, I dealt with the conductivity of metals, and this theory was based on the classical as well as the quantum free electron theory, and I had explained in detail how this quantum free electron theory was successful in explaining the failures of the classical free electron theory. Today, we'll look into the conductivity in the case of semiconductor, or in general, semiconductor physics. Now, we are all aware, semiconductors are the materials which have conductivity between conductors and insulators. There are various kinds of semiconductors which we have. If you look into the very pure semiconductor materials are silicon and germanium. Silicon is one of the very good semiconductor where it has got a small energy gap of 1.1 electron volt. And germanium is the other kind of semiconductor where it has the energy gap of just 0.67 electron volts. Other than those, there are two, the compound of semiconductors. They're all the product of gallium arsenide or cadmium selenide. And all these materials where their energy gap varies from around 1.3 electron volt to till around 2.1 electron volt. Now, due to their role in the fabrication of electronic devices, semiconductors are very important part of our lives. Today, we are having the various kind of applications of these electronic devices at whom we are using, could be a TV or maybe a mobile or a computer. And they're all applications of these semiconducting devices. And these semiconductors have a very narrow band gap. And that is the characteristic feature of the material. And this is what the energy gap of the semiconductor that I had explained in my previous classes, where the semiconductors have a very narrow gap. The gap is lesser than around 3 electron volts. If it is going to be greater than 3 electron volts, they become insulators. But in the case of metals, the valence band as well as the conduction band are overlapping, having no energy gap. Now, being smaller energy gap, it is possible that there are certain number of electrons that can be thermally excited from the valence band to the conduction band. And hence, we find there is some kind of conduction at room temperature. So every different kind of semiconductor materials have got different narrow energy gap. And based on the kind of material, we are able to see a difference in the conductivity of the semiconductors. If you look into the various kind of examples, now these are the various materials that we have as a semiconductor, which I already mentioned, starting with the very low energy gap, that is germanium. It has been generally represented by G, and it has got an energy gap of just 0.67 electron volts. But silicon is one of the very important and very significant semiconductor material represented as Si, where its energy gap is just 1.14 electron volts. If you look into gallium arsenide, represented as GaAs, it has got an energy gap of just 1.43 electron volts. Likewise, we have copper oxide, we have gallium phosphide, we have gallium nitride, and all these materials have got the energy gap of around 2.1 to around 3.4. So these are the various kind of semiconductor materials. Depending on the application of the devices, we can use the different kind of semiconductor materials. Now let us see how these semiconductors are being divided Semiconductors are generally being divided into two categories. The one is called the intrinsic semiconductor, and the second one is called as the extrinsic semiconductor. The word intrinsic means it is a pure, or semiconductor in its purest state is what we call as the intrinsic semiconductor. One of the most significant feature of all the semiconductor materials are that they are tetravalent. The word tetravalent means they have got four electrons in the last orbit, or in general they have got four valence electrons or free electrons. And each one electron of one atom is going to have a bond with the neighboring electron of the neighboring atom. And you can very clearly see here. Here every one silicon atom is being surrounded by the neighboring silicon atoms. So here the material in its purest state means there are no kind of impurities present. There are only silicon atoms are going to be present here. And every one silicon atom has got four electrons, valence electrons. And that is how one electron is able to bond with the neighboring electron. One electron is able to bond with the neighboring electron. And these bonds are called as the covalent bonds. Covalent bonds are being stronger in nature. So these electrons cannot be freed out at ordinary conditions, at very low temperatures. But it is possible when I increase the temperature of the material, there is breaking of the bonds taking place and all these electrons can be freed out. And hence there is a conductivity. Therefore, in the case of intrinsic semiconductor, when the temperature rises, the electrons are going to be freed out. And for every electron that is being emitted out or going to be freed out, there is one hole is going to be created. And this hole also significant in the case of semiconductor, because in the case of semiconductor, the conductivity is not only by the electrons, but also due to the holes. So as the temperature is raised in these semiconductors, one by one the covalent bonds are going to break and the electrons have been freed out, such that at any given condition the number of electrons and the number of holes are always going to be equal. The number of electrons and the number of holes are always going to be equal. Therefore, an intrinsic semiconductor is one where the number of electrons at any given temperature and the number of holes are going to be equal. Hence, they are equally distributing or equally contributing the current in the case of a semiconductor. Taking the second kind of semiconductor, we have extrinsic semiconductor. And in the extrinsic semiconductor means it is an impure semiconductor material. So where you are able to add some kind of impurity in it. And whenever we add the impurity, it could be an impurity having one electron in excess, or there may be one shortage of electron. So accordingly, the extrinsic semiconductor is been divided into two categories. One is N-type semiconductor and the second one is called the P-type semiconductor. First, let us see what is a N-type semiconductor. Now, in the N-type semiconductor, you will have to dope with a pentavalent material. You have to dope with a pentavalent material. What do you mean by pentavalent? A material which has got five valence electrons in its last orbit. Now, whenever I try to dope, you are going to dope in a very smallest fraction, maybe one atom in a million atoms of silicon. So here in the diagram, you can very clearly see that there are large number of silicon atoms are being surrounded by one phosphorus atom. But phosphorus being a pentavalent, it has got five electrons. Now, out of these five electrons, four electrons of the phosphorus are going to bond with the neighboring electrons. Four electrons are going to bond with the neighboring electrons. But you can see there is one electron which is being not bonded with any, and this is a free electron. This is a free electron. Therefore, In the n-type semiconductor, there is one excess electron that is going to be present in every atom that has been added into it. That is the reason that it is an excess electron. An electron being negative charged particle, we call it as there are excessive negative charged particle, hence it has been called as n-type. Therefore, for a n-type semiconductor, we'll have to add with the pentavalent element having one excess electron. But what will happen if I'm going to add with a trivalent atom like aluminium or boron? Where when aluminium is added into a pure semiconductor material, the aluminium atom replaces one silicon atom, where aluminium atom is a trivalent. It has got three electrons in the last orbit. So the three electrons of the last orbit of the aluminium are going to bond with the three neighboring electrons of the neighboring atom. But there is no electron to bond with the electron of a silicon. Immediately, this aluminium atom is going to create a hole in it, which is nothing but a vacant space has been created to attract or to accept one electron out of it. Therefore, I can say all the electrons have been bonding with the covalent bonds here, but there is one excess hole is going to be created. One excess hole is going to be created. Since there is an excess hole by one atom, and if there are n such a number of atoms are being doped, there are n such a number of holes are being created, and hole being the vacant space of an electron, we assume it is a positive charged particle. Hence, the material which are being doped by trivalent material is called a p-type semiconductor material. So this is how the semiconductor materials are being divided into intrinsic as well as extrinsic, where intrinsic in its purest state, but extrinsic with the impurities have been added. But in the extrinsic, once again, n-type and p-type semiconductor based on pentavalent element is being doped or trivalent element is being doped. Now let us try to see the intrinsic semiconductor in detail. Now, in the case of intrinsic semiconductor, where we can see the atoms are being individually are coming closer. And as they come closer, you can see every one electron is able to bond with the neighboring electron. So there are covalent bonds. This is how the formation of the bonds are going to take place. And due to this formation of the bonds, none of the electrons at absolute zero Kelvin are free. There are no electrons are able to conduct at absolute zero Kelvin. And there is a reason that every semiconductor at absolute zero Kelvin is an insulator. It is an insulator. Because one electron is able to bond with the neighboring. Every one electron is able to bond with the neighboring electron. So what exactly is going to happen when I'm going to increase the temperature? As soon as I try to increase the temperature, or when you apply a certain amount of electric field, the electrons are able to conduct, and the conductive process is being seen by means of the animation in the diagram, where the electrons will jump from one location to the other locations and the other to the other location. This is how you are able to see the electrons that are being able to conduct. And you can see the total number of electrons that are able to conduct and the total number of holes that are there are equal. Hence, in the case of a pure semiconductor material, the conductivity is not only based on the electrons, but also due to the holes. And the number of electrons and the number of holes are equal, equally contributing. But you see, in the case of extrinsic semiconductor, let us try to see the first example, that is a n-type semiconductor, as I already mentioned, where there are one excess electron that has been present. It is free even at very low temperature because all the other four electrons are been bonding with the neighboring electron. And all these bonds are very stronger. They are called as a covalent bonds. But when you try to apply a certain amount of temperature or when you try to apply a certain potential across the given semiconductor, You can very clearly see that the electrons are moving round, and this electron is being freed out and it is able to move. And at the same time, there are certain number of bonds are being breaking, creating the holes, and the electrons are able to move from one corner to the other corner. But at any given time, the number of electrons are greater than the number of holes. Hence, the conductivity in the case of an n-type semiconductor is more due to the electron compared to that of the holes. Therefore, we can call the electrons are the majority charge carriers and the holes are the minority charge carriers. But one thing is very sure, that the conductivity is not only due to the electrons but also due to the holes. But only one observation is that the conductivity to the electron is more, hence they are the majority charge carriers. But the holes are the minority charge carriers. So this is how we are able to see the conductivity of the semiconductors in the n-type. But look into the conductivity in the case of a p-type semiconductor. In the case of a p-type semiconductor, where we try to dope with the trivalent element, it could be aluminium or could be boron, where there are three electrons are able to bond with the neighboring electrons, but there exists a hole. There exists a hole here. Therefore, there is one excess hole is being present in the semiconductor material. So what exactly is going to happen if I am going to apply a certain amount of temperature or a certain potential being applied? You can see the electrons are from one atom, they are able to jump to the neighboring atom, breaking the covalent bonds. But at any given stage, you can see the number of holes are going to be greater than the number of electrons. Hence, we can say the holes are the majority charge carriers and the electrons are the minority charge carriers. Therefore, the conductivity in the case of a p-type semiconductor is due to the sum of the conductivity of the holes as well as the electrons, but the conductivity due to the holes are more compared to that of the conductivity due to the electrons. Both are able to conduct, and this is how the conductivity can be controlled by means of doping. Therefore, one thing is very clear. In the case of a semiconductor material in its purest state, for every one electron, there is a hole being created at any given temperature. And there is a reason that you are not able to vary the number of electrons and the number of holes at any given conditions. But it is possible in the case of an extrinsic semiconductor, either you are able to increase the number of electrons or you are able to increase the number of holes. So based on the hole concentration or the electron concentration, the conductivity can be controlled in a better manner. And there is a reason that extrinsic semiconductor materials are more popular than that of the intrinsic semiconducting materials. Now, to understand the conductivity of the semiconductor materials, we require to understand the concept which I already mentioned in my previous chapter, that is a Fermi level. What is the Fermi level that I explained? Fermi level, which I mentioned, that it is the highest occupied level of the electron at absolute zero Kelvin. Now, even in the case of semiconductor, the Fermi level is very significant. Just based on the Fermi level, one can really identify or able to differentiate the conductivity of the material. And this Fermi level distinguishes the energy position of the filled as well as the unfilled energy states, which are very well known. And this signifies the average energy value of the conduction electrons in all the energy levels. See, the Fermi level is the highest occupied level of the electrons, which differentiate between the lower energy levels as well as higher. And the lower are the filled energy levels and the higher are unfilled energy levels by the electrons. So this Fermi level determines the probability of electron occupancy at any given temperature at various energy levels. What exactly is going to happen as the temperature raised? As the temperature is raised, the electrons below the Fermi level are able to jump to the higher energy level, and they are able to occupy the higher energy levels, especially in the case in the conduction band, and they are able to conduct. Therefore, as the temperature increases, the available thermal energy, which can be measured in terms of a quantity called KT, where K is the Boltzmann constant and T is the absolute temperature. So KT is the amount of energy, increases. The electrons will be elevated to the higher energy levels. It will also increase the EF. At the same time, as the temperature decreases, therefore the EF also is going to be decreasing. Therefore, one thing is very clear, that in the case of semiconductor, the EF is a temperature dependent factor. EF also depends on the amount of doping. So by increasing the thermal energy, the value of EF can be increased, or by decreasing the temperature, the value of EF can be decreased. And based on this, let us look into how this Fermi level been found in the intrinsic semiconducting material. Now, in the case of intrinsic semiconductor material, you find the Fermi level is exactly at the middle of the valence band as well as the conduction band. We have valence band here, we have the conduction band here, and in between there is an energy gap. This is the forbidden energy gap. But if you really see, the Fermi level comes exactly at the middle of the energy gap. And we are able to prove this maybe a little later. And this indicates there are equal concentration of free electrons as well as holes. This is only in the case of a pure intrinsic semiconductor. And at absolute zero Kelvin, all the energy levels in the valence band are completely filled and all the conduction band are completely empty. That means there are no electrons are being found in the conduction band at absolute zero Kelvin, but the valence band, there are quite a large number of electrons are being present. But the conductivity of any given material takes place only and only when if we find the electrons in the conduction band. Therefore, we are able to conduct the electricity in the case of semiconductor only at certain ordinary temperatures. And at this ordinary temperatures, some of the electrons at the topmost band of the valence are able to jump to the lowermost band of the conduction band, and then they are able to conduct. Therefore, the conductivity is entirely depends on the amount of energy gap the material has. So, depending on the temperature, you are able to see the number of electrons able to jump from the valence band to the conduction band, and they are able to conduct. More and more is exactly the temperature, there is more and more conduction that is going to take place. So let us see how many number of electrons are going to be present in a semiconductor at ordinary temperatures or at very low temperatures. And that is what we call as a carrier concentration in an intrinsic semiconductor. The word carrier concentration is the total number of electrons that are being present in the semiconducting material. And this number of electrons are able to change based on the amount of temperature. Therefore, the electron concentration is the number of electrons in the conduction band per unit volume of the material. And that is represented by Ne, which is being given by the relation 4 root 2 divided by h cube into pi me star into k into t all to the power 3 by 2 into e to the power ef minus eg by kt. Here 4 root 2 by h cube is a constant. Pi is a constant and me star is the effective mass of the electron. K is the Boltzmann constant. T is the temperature. And here EF is the Fermi energy, EG is the energy gap, K is once again the Boltzmann constant, and T is the absolute temperature. Therefore, you can very clearly see that the number of free electrons in the conduction band per unit volume of the material mainly depends on, one is the Me star, that is the effective mass of the electron. Second thing is that it depends on the Fermi factor, that is EF, Fermi energy, and the energy gap. However, as the temperature is changed, the value of Ne also going to change. But these are the total number of electrons that are available for the conduction process. In a very similar manner, we can also try to find out what are exactly the hole concentration. That means, how many number of electrons are going to be present per unit volume in the valence band of the material, which can be represented as NH. And this NH is once again given by a similar equation, 4 into root 2 divided by H cube into pi MH star into KT to the power 3 by 2 into E to the power minus EF by KT. One thing is made very clear. Here, in the case of hole concentration, the effective mass of the holes should be taken into consideration. And the hole concentration is independent of the energy gap. It is independent of the energy gap. It only depends on the Fermi energy. Therefore, NH is equal to 4 root 2 by H cube, which is a constant, pi MH star KT 1 to the power 3 by 2, where T is a variable, MH star for a given material is a constant, and E to the power minus EF by KT, where EF is purely a material dependent. Okay, so here once again, M star is the effective mass of the hole. Okay, EG is the energy gap and K is the Boltzmann constant. So we are easily able to know what is the total number of electrons that are going to be present per unit volume in the valence band at any given temperature, as well as the total number of holes present in the valence band per unit volume of the material at any given temperature. Naturally, with the increase in the temperature, the number of free electrons are also going to increase, the number of holes are also going to increase. So let us look into, based on the number of electrons and then based on the number of holes, how do we able to relate the Fermi energy as well as the energy gap? And through this equation, we are able to find out where exactly the Fermi energy lies in the case of a pure intrinsic semiconductor material. So let us try to consider a pure semiconductor material, as I already mentioned. In the case of pure semiconductor material, the number of electrons and the number of holes are equal, because every one electron is going to bond with the neighboring electron. Every one electron is going to bond with the neighboring electron. As the temperature is raised, the free electrons are being freed out, and it is going to create a hole. So for every one hole, there is one electron is going to be created. Every one electron, there is a hole being created. Therefore, the number of holes and the number of electrons are always going to be equal. Now, if that is so, we have just now come across what is NE. NE is nothing but it is going to be 4 root 2 by H cube into pi ME star into KT to the power 3 by 2 into E to the power EF minus EG by KT, and which is equal to NH, which is equal to 4 root 2 by H cube into pi MH star into KT to the power 3 by 2 into E to the power minus EF by KT. Now, they being equal, we can cancel the like terms. Here 4 root 2 by H cube get cancelled with this 4 root 2 by H cube. Pi get cancelled with the pi here. KT is going to get cancelled with the KT here. The only remaining factor here is ME star to the power 3 by 2 and into E to the power EF minus EG by KT. And on the right hand side, MH star to the power 3 by 2 into E to the power EF by KT. And that is what the equation written here. So, ME star to the power 3 by 2 into E to the power EF minus EG by KT, which is equal to MH star to the power 3 by 2 into E to the power EF minus EF by KT. Now, what you all do is that you rewrite this equation. Try to take this term E to the power minus EF by KT to the left hand side, and this ME star to the power 3 by 2, you try to take it to the right hand side, and rearrange this equation, you are going to get E to the power minus 2F minus EG by KT, because here we have already one EF, and this EF, when it has been brought to the left hand side, it becomes plus EF, so there are 2F minus EG divided by KT, which is equal to MH star to the power 3 by 2 divided by ME star to the power 3 by 2, or MH star divided by ME star whole to the power 3 by 2. Or, now what you all do is that you try to take the logarithm on either side, the logarithm to the base e, so that we are able to cancel this exponential term. And when you try to take the logarithm, you get the above equation as 2EF minus EG by KT, which is equal to 3 by 2 into ln of MH star divided by ME star. Okay? So you try to rearrange this equation. Once again, try to push this Kt onto the right hand side and this Eg onto the right hand side, and this 2EF that just directly can be written as EF is equal to this 2 can be brought here, it become 3 by 4 into Kt into ln of MH star by ME star plus Eg by 2. Okay, now this is the expression for the Fermi energy. This is the expression for the Fermi energy for any given semiconductive material in its purest state. However, if you consider under the practical considerations, the mass of the hole, that is the effective mass of the hole and the effective mass of the electrons are almost equal. In the case of a pure semiconductor, they are almost equal. So, we can write the above equation as EF is equal to Eg by 2. It is because ln of MH star by ME star, where it is going to equal, therefore ln of 1 is nothing but 0. Hence, the whole factor is going to be equal to 0. Hence, the Fermi energy is equal to Eg by 2. And this clearly says that the Fermi level always lies at the mid part of the forbidden energy gap for an intrinsic semiconductive material. Therefore, in the case of a pure semiconductive material, the Fermi energy always lies at the middle of the energy gap. Therefore, this is true only in the case of a pure semiconducting material, but it need not be true in the case of an extrinsic semiconducting material. Thank you.